Hey there, Manna Church. Pastor Nick here. I want to say welcome to Manna Online. We are so stoked to have you with us. Thanks for tuning in. We're really excited about our message today. I really believe that God has something special for you today. Also, we're going to be celebrating some communion together. So we want to encourage you, if you're a follower of Jesus, you're welcome to partake with us. And really, you can use anything around your house, anything in the kitchen, so some bread and juice, or maybe just coffee and a donut. Really, what matters is what it represents. So we want to encourage you to participate with us when that comes up. But for right now, let's go ahead and posture our hearts as we sing some songs and worship together.
And I am who you say I am.
Amen. Listen, right now we want to go ahead and take communion together as a church body, and we want to invite you to be a part of that. So if you're a follower of Jesus, go ahead and grab whatever you've got laying around the house, whatever's in the kitchen. Maybe it's some bread and juice, or maybe it's just a coffee and a donut. What it represents is more important. It represents the body of Christ and the blood of Jesus that was shed for us. So go ahead and take whatever you're eating there. And as you hold that, let's remember Jesus' sacrifice on the cross for us, his body that was broken. He was broken so that we could experience wholeness. He bore stripes on his back so that we could experience healing. So Lord, we come to you right now. God, we thank you that you sent your son on our behalf to die on the cross, and now we take this in remembrance of you. Go ahead and eat that. You know, in the same way, whatever you've got to drink there, what it's representing is the blood of Jesus. Scripture tells us that there's no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. So Lord, we come to you now. Jesus, we thank you for the blood that you shed on our behalf. Thank you that it cleanses us of all wrongdoing so that we can be in right standing with God. So as we take this right now, we take it in remembrance of you. Go ahead and drink that. Now, Lord, we just conclude this moment by saying thank you for your continual work in our lives. Continue to transform us. Continue to make us and shape us into the men and women that you've called us to be so we can continue advancing your kingdom and making it hard to go to hell from planet Earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, listen, I want to say welcome to all of you who are with us, especially if this is your very first time. Maybe you've been here before and you've never clicked that guest button, or you've never texted us, or maybe this genuinely is your first time. Either way, we want to welcome you, and I want to encourage you to go ahead and text that number that you see on the screen. Go ahead and text guest to that number, or if you're viewing on the Manna website, manna.church, you'll see that there's a little button down there that says first time guest. You can click that button. We want to encourage you to do that because we want to reach out to you, see how we can support you, pray for you, and see how we can resource you best as you journey with Jesus. So feel free to go ahead and pause the video if you need to. Reach out to us. We'd love to hear from you. Also, maybe you're here today and you're prepared to give. If that's you, we want to say thank you so much. We really are grateful for you. There's a couple of easy ways you can do that. You can always give online at our website, manna.church, or through our smartphone app. Just look for Manna Church on wherever you get your apps from on the App Store. And so you can always give those ways, or you can send us something to our office right here. Send it to the Cliffdale site in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region. You can just mail it in right there. But let's go ahead and pray as we receive the offering together. Lord, we are grateful for what you're doing in our lives and through our lives as we reach out to the community and make you famous. And now, Lord, we ask that you would bless everything that's given, multiply it to continue advancing your kingdom. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, check it out. Listen, we've got part 7 of When Your Back's Against the Wall coming at you. But first, check out these video announcements.
Hey there, Manna Church. Man, it is such a privilege for Christopher and myself. Together we are Wild Stallions. Little Bill and Ted reference for you. For those of us our age, you got it.
For you 90s kids.
I think they're making another one.
Keep up, millennials.
So, or they did make another one. Doesn't matter. Look, we are together because we have the honor of inviting you to a very special evening. And I want you to recognize how special this is, because not every day does somebody say, come celebrate this guy for 40 years of pastoring. What are we talking about?
40 years, man. There's a lot of that 40 going on. Anyway, on October the 3rd, Sunday night at 6:30 p.m. at the Cliffdale site, we're going to celebrate the legacy of our dad, Michael Fletcher. 40 years of service to Manna Church. We're going to talk about the legacy of where he's been, what he's meant to our local church, and his plan for the future and how this impacts the church here in Fayetteville, Fort Bragg, but also the movement as a whole. So we want to invite you. What do we want to invite him to do?
We want to invite you to come. Come hang out with us. You're a part of this. This is really, when you celebrate a pastor, you're celebrating a church. So we really want you to be there. Consider this our personal invitation to you to show up. Chris will tell you the times again because I have already forgotten them. It's October 3rd at 6:30 p.m. Boom! I did know it.
He did.
I did know it.
Because
you want to be there.
You want to be there.
100%
All right.
True.
We love you. Say bye to the people.
Bye to the people. Hey there, Manna Church Online. It is time to finish off this series. That's right. We are in the final week of a 7-part series that we have called When Your Back's Against the Wall. And of course, you go, 7 weeks for when your back's against the wall? That makes a lot of sense. But if you've been following along with us, you know that for this series, we've been studying in Psalm 143. And if you know Psalm 143 pretty well, you go, that is only 12 verses long. We're doing 7 weeks, finishing off 7 weeks of a series with only 12 verses in Psalm 143. And that is exactly right, because this is one of those places where there are 12 really powerful verses that I don't want us to just understand. I want us to get very deeply. So let me give you again, you know this story because we talked about it a little bit. Let me tell you how this series came to be. It started out in our senior pastor, I call him Dad, started out in our senior pastor's devotional life. He's just reading along, came to Psalm 143, and as he was praying and meditating on it, it started to pop out to him. Some of these prayers and noticing that there were 7 prayers and this process that David lays out, and I'll get to what that looks like, the problem, the process, the prayers, and the preservation. I'll get to that in a minute, but it all started just from him meeting with God and hearing about these prayers, these principles in this psalm as he studied it. And then he had, you know, our staff has what we call an all staff. Once a month as a staff, we get together, we have a chapel, we worship, we hear a message, and then we just kind of meet and talk about what's going on in the staff. It's a great time, we really enjoy it. But this all staff was different. This all staff, our senior pastor Michael, he had an extended time. So you know what I'm gonna do? I'm going to take this, which God has been showing me in my devotions, and I'm just going to kind of minister it. It's like an experience that we had. We were in the worship center at the Cliffdale site, and everybody spread out, like way spread out, just to get some room to ourselves, little notebook, a Bible, and just walk through Psalm 143. We stopped. We prayed the prayers, but it was great. This was a year ago or longer even. And then we started to plan later for this series. And as we sat down and we looked at the year and what we could put, the idea of when your back's against the wall came back. And then these 7 prayers that we pray when we find ourselves with our back against the wall. And so as he and I were meeting and we were talking about the series and how it's laid out and what's going on, he started to just reflect for a minute. And he said, you know, I wonder how many people sitting in that special staff time just saw this as an experience that we had once versus how many put it into practice. And if I'm all the way honest, I think I've said this before in this series, I kind of paused and felt some conviction in my own heart because I realized, you know what? I looked at a lot of what happened in that one time as an experience. So I started to do something for myself, just on my own, started to go back and read Psalm 143. In addition to my other Bible reading and my devotional time, I started reading it every day. Just, I'm going to read my devotions and then go back to Psalm 143 and back to Psalm 143. Then I prayed through Psalm 143 all on my own. And then the genius, and I don't think it's our genius, but I think God's in this. This idea of taking 7 weeks and going through all 12 verses time and again started to get a hold of my heart, because this is not one of those series that we're doing in a linear fashion, almost a Greek way of learning. This is more Hebraic, where we're going in a circle and going a little bit deeper each time and experiencing a little bit more nuance, and not even just in how we're preaching it. See, I think what God is doing in all of our hearts is he's taking every one of us just a little bit deeper, a little more understanding, a little more application as we walk through the same things and we open ourselves up. I hope that's how all of us are coming to this. Wherever you're sitting, however you're watching, you could be on a subway, you could be gathered with your family watching on an Apple TV, you could be on vacation. I don't know how you're experiencing this, but I hope that what you're doing is you're coming to it with that desire. God, I want you to work something in me. I want you to make my spirit come alive so that my soul understands what uniquely and specifically you're pouring into me to prepare me, to develop me, to work in me so that if your back's against the wall right now, you know the next step and what to do. If you're in that place where your back's not against the wall, but you can reflect back on those places where you have been, and you know that God is continuing to work in you, so you're better prepared to walk with him when you come to that place. I hope that's how all of us are approaching this, and I love how this culminates today. I think it's so well laid out. I think David picked the order of how he walked through each of these prayers on purpose, and that leads us to the final prayer today when we find ourselves with our back against the wall. But before I get to that, I want to tell you a story I read about a CEO. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I enjoy reading business books and narratives about leadership and what this CEO learned and applied and case studies and what that looks like. So I heard about a CEO and he's brought into a company to bring a little bit of a shakeup. And so he comes in and he's done his research. He's looked at how they operate. He's checked all that out. And he says, you know what? The first way I'm going to make my mark on this company is I'm going to get rid of the slackers. That's his plan. And so he's looking for that opportunity. And as he comes in, the company throws a welcome party and takes him on the tour of a tour of the facilities. So he's looking at this and these offices and that offices and this conference room. And at that time, as he's walking through, he notices that there's a guy who's just kind of leaning against a wall. And so, you know, there's a whole bunch of workers gathered and they're obviously having a meeting and they've got some food there and they're engaged, but there's a guy who's just standing off to the side. And so at that moment, he saw an opportunity he had been waiting for. He said, I'm going to show them that I really mean business. So he goes up just to that guy in front of all of them. He doesn't try and make it quiet. He's trying to make a point. He walks up and goes, how much money do you make? And so the guy, like, is surprised, obviously shocked that the CEO is speaking to him. And he goes, $400. Why? The CEO says, wait right here. At this point, everybody's eyes are on them. People are asking, what's going on? Why is he doing this? He leaves, he walks to his office, and he comes back just a minute later, and he's holding cash in his hand. And he takes out $1,600. He counts them out, one, two, three, all the way up to 16 in cash. He says, here's 4 weeks' pay. Now get out and don't come back. At that moment, he's feeling like, man, I've made my point. He looks around. He's kind of got a little bit, I know what I'm doing. And he looks around and says to the other people, now, can anybody tell me what that goofball's job was? And from across the room, the guy says, actually, that was the pizza delivery guy. How is it related to his back's against the wall? He was leaning against the wall. That's it. Okay. If you got your Bible, open it, if you would, to Psalm 143. Hopefully, at this point, our Bibles pretty much fall open to that place because we've been studying there for 7 weeks. We're on to some special new stuff next week. You'll see what that is. But for now, Psalm 143, one more time. And you know that this is one of those psalms that I think of as one of David's cave psalms. Say, cave psalms, what are you talking about? Well, we all remember there's 150 psalms, and they have different purposes. They're not all the same. We're familiar with what I've just talked about as the cave psalms. We know what those are like. We've read Psalm 22. That's the psalm that Jesus quotes when he's on the cross. It starts out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And he goes on to describe how difficult it is in the moment, what he's experiencing. And David is kind of talking about what's going on in his life, but he's even prophesying forward to what's happening with Jesus. And it's verse after verse where things have gotten horrible. And then it's got that turn and it goes to the positive. We're familiar with those. We probably, all of us at some point in our life, have turned to the Psalms to find those Psalms and discover again that encouragement that comes at the end of where we identify with the heart of the psalmist as he pours out his, oh, I'm undone. My bones are out of joint. It feels like there's gravel in my teeth. All those different places. Those are the
cave psalms. And there's psalms like the Psalms of Ascent, which pilgrims would sing as they're making their way to Jerusalem on their way to make sacrifice. And these are encouraging psalms, the psalms of worship. It builds them up. There's different psalms for different purposes. But in my mind, Psalm 143 is one of those psalms that's like, it's like David has looked back at the psalms that he's written and kind of what I think of as the cave psalms. And he knows that he's shown people that there's a way to connect with God. That this place where they were, where we are sometimes, with our back against the wall, where it feels like we're overwhelmed, where the waves have washed over us and we can't fight our way to the top, where it doesn't look like there's light at the end of the tunnel. He knows that people will read psalms that he's written and they'll be encouraged. He knows that there's the idea that there's hope out there, that you can connect with God and God will bring that restoration that you so crave, and that God can be that rescuer that we so desire. But it's almost to me like with this psalm, David looks around and he's learned over the course of his life that his secret sauce, what makes him successful, is not his great brain, it's not his physical ability, it's not his military acumen, it's not his wisdom. What makes David so successful against everybody else is the fact that he knows how to get a hold of God. And it's almost to me like the rest of those psalms that show that David has connected with God aren't quite enough. And so he writes this psalm that's a descriptive psalm that describes the process. Here's how I do it, guys. It's almost like God is so gracious to you and me to give us this tremendous example, but also include in our sacred texts this guide on how we can find God in the midst of our circumstances. I think that's why David does this psalm this way. I think that's why he lays out the problem. That feeling, angst on the inside, pressure from the outside, an acknowledgement that it could be his own sin, a stake in the ground that we need to hold on to, the depth of how horrible this pain is, all in the problem, and yet, without specifics, without pinning it to this particular moment in his life. And in that, all of us then finding in these words, in this description, a familiar feeling. Our own moments of having our back against the wall and going, man, I can relate to the places where it's been my own fault, it's been my sin. I can relate to the places where everything seems good on the outside, and a dispassionate observer of just my exterior might feel like everything's fine, but deep on the inside, in my inner person, in my emotions, my back's against the wall. Or those places where it's like, I'm opposed by somebody else. They're after me. They're out to get me. And in that, my back's against. All of those are there in that beginning of the problem. And then David is so gracious. And really, it's the Holy Spirit speaking through David, through time, to your heart and mine, to lay out for us the process. A process every one of us probably has walked through. Not explicitly. It's not like we've necessarily, hopefully through the series we've started to, but it's not like in our past we've sat down and said, I'm going to do this and then this and then this. But in various times we've found ourselves where we're remembering what God has done and we're meditating on how he's worked in our lives and we're pondering the work of his hands and we're finding ourselves in worship. That's the process. But David makes it clear. Here's how you walk it. Here's how you apply it. And then in the prayers, verses 7 through 10 of Psalm 143, where David, it's like he grabs large categories. And it's not about the specifics of the prayer, though, in that each of those prayers have like, hey, Lord, I need help with this, the prayer of desperation. And then some of the key to that, we'll see that as we look at our prayer today, the final prayer of this series. But it's like David captures those large categories of what we need from God, what our heart yearns for from Him, and places them in seven prayers that at various times we can remember. You know, I need to turn. Last week we talked about instruction. I need to learn from where I've been. It's not enough to just get pulled out of this circumstance. I need to recognize what God has been after to work in me, because I know He's restoring me and I know He's preparing me for a future that's far beyond what I've even dreamed and imagined. So I've got to learn. I need to hear His voice. I need Him to deliver me all those prayers that are encapsulated. And then ultimately, that thing that all of us look for, that all of us hope for as we read through the Psalms. A lot of times we go to these cave Psalms because we're feeling that angst and those emotions, and we feel alone and we feel undone. And we do want to find ourselves in those words and say, yeah, that's my experience. David's got it. That's what I'm going through. But really what we yearn for is that hope at the end, that God will, that God can, that God has, that we are preserved, that we're rescued, that we're saved. And we find that in this psalm as well. David doesn't leave us. He says, no, 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 God will. That's in verses 11 and 12. We call that the preservation. You've heard this psalm before, but allow me to give it to you again. Verse 1, this is the problem. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ears to my pleas for mercy. Again, this is David exploring what's going on in his own heart. I've described that thus far. And then we always pause at this section, and you know that. In your faithfulness, answer me. In your righteousness. Again, we've looked at that in so many different directions, from wondering, is this just spiritual language that David records? Is there something specific that he's after? Again, he's not specific in describing the problem, but this sounds specific. In your faithfulness, in your righteousness, he's reaching out to God and he's doing it on purpose. You know how we've defined this thus far. Faithfulness is that expression of the heart, that recognition, regardless of what my circumstances say, regardless of what I feel, it is my heart's understanding, it is my faith recognizing that you are dependable. It's that confession that I hope has become a part of your lexicon, a part of your life, where you say, listen, God, I'm holding this. I'm staking this into the ground. You are good. I don't care how the enemy tries to tell me that's not true. I don't care how my own brain tries to process through what's going on and wants to question if you're good. I'm holding this at the beginning, at the outset. You're good. And then you're righteous. Another way of thinking that, you're true. The way I like to define it, you always and only do what is right. This is one of those places where this statement has been, it's more than a statement. This prayer, this confession has been a friend, a companion to me as I've walked through my life and experienced those back against the wall moments. I've always known, I was fortunate enough to grow up in a fantastic family with great education about God. I felt called to full-time vocational ministry when I was 11. I've been studying the Word and wanting to be able to minister from the Word for basically all of my life. So I have studied God, read the theology. I have always known that God is good, that God is the author of good. He's not the author of evil. But where this specific refrain, this specific prayer really became real to me beyond my understanding, but to the place where I believe, was when my father-in-law, he wasn't my father-in-law yet, but I was in love with his daughter, when he passed away from cancer. And everybody loved him. He was our worship pastor way back in the day. It's actually one of the last conversations he had with my dad. He told my dad, and my dad said this at Heather and my wedding. He told the story of how David had said, I want your son to marry my daughter. It was a beautiful moment. Loved him to death. But ultimately, he passed away from cancer. And it was one of those places where the entire church and everybody was just rocked. It's like, this is not how we saw this going. I can't tell you how much I prayed with as much earnestness and faith I could muster, believing that this is not the way it was going to go. And so that's one of those moments where I'm truly grateful for my dad, who led me and us all with this reality. And what was knowledge really became real in my heart. Honestly, I can tell you where I was. I was driving in between Fayetteville and Campbell University. I was getting close to Boyce Creek, and I was praying on this topic. Like, I don't understand what's happening, but from this place, God, you're good, and you always and only do what is right. And that which was a concept became a reality. And I recognized that God is in control, and he is good and always and only does what is right. So I encourage you, wherever you are, whatever you're facing, you hold to that as your foundation. And when we do, we're prepared for God to minister to our hearts and bring the healing we so desire. All right, back into the psalm, verse 2. He continues, enter not into judgment with your servant, for no one living is righteous before you. Again, that's that place where he admits he's a sinner and this could be his fault, the result of his inherent sinfulness. He goes on to define, but not his enemy, for the enemy, who is it? We don't know, has pursued my soul. He's crushed my life to the ground. He's made me sit in darkness like those long dead. Again, the point here, and this is where we've made this point, the point is not how he got here. The point is that his back's against the wall and he's in pain. And my point is not preaching a message about how you got where you are. It's that you're there and you need God in that place. Therefore, my spirit faints within me. My heart within me is appalled. David brings us to the depth of desolation. I can't believe how bad things are on the inside. It's like, I just never thought it would be here. I'm tempted to define that more, but you don't need me to. Because your heart, you know, you can pause right now and recollect. Or even you could pause right now and say, Fletch, I'm right there right now where my heart is appalled. So David is, that's what I love about his walk with God. And what I hope will be your walk with God. I know that David is battling fear in these places. I know that worry is trying to get the best of him. I'm sure of that. I'm sure that there's angst and frustration. I'm sure that his desire is to shift the blame. I'm sure that's true for him and for all of us. But I love that he has learned, and I hope we learn, that he's not afraid to express, even to feel all of those things in God's presence. Because he knows the process is next. And the process is where we encounter God again and restoration begins. And so he's willing to say, look, here's what's going on around me, and I'm not afraid to walk into your presence with it because I know that you're good and you always and only do what is right. And I see David here, and I hope it's true for you as you walk through your life and this becomes a part of the everyday. He walks down a tried and true path where he says, I remember the days of old. He says, I'm going to recall because I've been wise to record them. I hope that's one of the things that you've gotten in this, is that we would be wise to record the deliverance of God in our past, in our present, as we walk through it. The Israelites were tremendous at this. They'd make monuments that say, look, I want my children and my children's children and kids I've never even thought about to be able to look at this, and then we can tell the stories of remembrance of how great God has been. So where you are, this is one of those places. This is the process to remember the days of old and to look back at the display of God's power in your past. And as you look back, to meditate on all that he has done. And so this is not just remembering. This has gone beyond remembering. This is contemplative. This is where, in my mind's eye, I'm not just remembering how great God has been. I'm starting in my soul to ruminate on, to mull over, to walk through the implications of what that means and what that says about God's character. Like, who is this God that I know who's rescued me so deeply? How powerful is it that he has been my healer? What does that say about him? And I think and I mull over that he is my healer and I can trust him. And I ponder, he is my banner. Jehovah, you know, where he describes, I am your banner. He goes before me. He, you know, undergirds me. He's fought the battle that I'm afraid of and already won it. So you meditate, and it's personal. It's about your past deliverances and who God is. See, I think that's the thing. The process, and even some of the some of the problem, has me focusing much of my time and energy on where I am and what's against me. And the process is that pathway that I walk where I remember how God's rescued me before, but it starts to shift my focus from where I am and what's gone wrong and how bad this problem is to who God is, who he has been in my life, and then larger even than just me, because God is my God. He's personal to me. He's big words, imminent and transcendent. Like, I can know him, but beyond that, he's beyond my comprehension. He's greater. He works wonders, and he's worked that throughout history, and it's bigger than just me. It's a grand scale. So I go from meditating on what God has been to me as an individual and the depth of that and my safety because of that to how great and grand God is. So now I'm really beholding him in his wonder, and my problem has gotten so much smaller because I'm looking at him, which leads me always to worship, where I stretch out my hands. And that's the next step in this process, where he says, I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land. I hope you've had that experience. It's so powerful when you could be coming from one of those dreadfully horrible places where it's just the worst. And then there's kind of that, sometimes even hard to go into prayer in those places because you're just so overwhelmed by it. And your prayer could even start almost frustrated, whiny even. But something as you pursue God in that, you say, you know what, darn it. I don't even like the sound of these prayers, but I'm going to find God in this place. And then the Holy Spirit walks in. It seems like, I mean, he's been there the whole time, but it seems like the Holy Spirit walks in the room. And sometimes I've been in that place of prayer, and it's like the room doesn't change. I'm sitting in the same spot, but it's like everything in the room changes. I mean, it's like it's totally different. And somehow, in that place, as I recognize, God, you're here, like hunger, this is what my soul thirsts for you, thirst for God, like that I didn't even know was there, all of a sudden springs up because he's there. And so that's that worship where I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you. I'm just going to see, I'm just going to pause in this place. It's that sacrifice of worship. It's beautiful worship. And when I've been in that place, it's like where the Holy Spirit enters, you go, you're here. I'm telling you, faith. I mean, it's not always like overwhelming faith. Sometimes it's like a trickle of faith. Sometimes like, yeah, but faith pops up, which has prepared me to pray, not in a whine. Many people whining, oh, I'm just going to go and pray with God. God, I need this and I need that and this isn't working. That's whining and calling it prayer. So not like a whine, but with faith that God will. begin to pray. And we know these prayers. We've read them before. David starts out with that prayer of desperation. Answer me quickly, O Lord. My spirit failed. It's got to be you that shows up. But something's changed. The process has changed his inside. So faith is a part of this prayer. It's answer me quickly with expectation. Every person has prayed from wine from a place of aloneness with no faith because they're still focused on themselves and their problem. They're praying, but they're not even looking at God, as it were, so it's whining. No, this prayer is a prayer of faith. Hide not your face from me, lest I be like those who go down to the pit. I love the faith that has infected David, because I hear in this prayer, he says, you know what? You're here, and I'm finding you. I'm not in doubt whether or not you're in this place. I'm not in doubt of your presence. I'm hanging out here until you show me, because you got what I need, which leads him to, let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love. Like, I'm going to show up and I'm going to start talking to you because I know you're going to talk back. I trust you, for in you I trust. And at that point, then he is able to say, make me know the way I should go. Look, it's misty in front of me. I don't know where to turn, but you do. I'm lifting up my soul to you. Give me that guidance. Show me what I'm going to do with the faith, the trust, the knowledge that you're going to deliver me. Deliver me from my enemies, O Lord. I have fled to you from refuge. This isn't propositional. This isn't, hey, God, maybe. This isn't like, I wonder if you could. Maybe it works out this time. Maybe it doesn't. No, this is deliver. I have faith. I have trust. Sometimes it's surging. Sometimes it's a tiny bit, but the trust is there. Last week, teach me to do your will. For you are my God. Instruct me. I don't want to waste this pain. I want to recognize why you allowed this so that you could work in me to lead me where you want me to go. And then it's capped off with this beautiful prayer. Let's not miss it. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. I'll come back to that, on level ground, and how powerful that is. This is the prayer of submission. Throughout this series, a couple times actually, I told you part of the story of King Hezekiah. We found it in Isaiah 38. A lot of times we haven't put that up on the screen. We'll put it up now. It says, in those days, Hezekiah became sick and was at the point of death. And Isaiah, the prophet, the son of Amos, came to him and said, thus says the Lord, set your house in order, for you shall die, you shall not recover. And we know that Hezekiah was desperate when he heard the news, but he doesn't call out to Isaiah. You'd think that he would. You'd think that he'd like grab him. Hold on. No, you can't leave until this changes. Look, you're the prophet. You've got the red bat phone. You call, God answers. I want a new answer. You're not leaving until you get me one. No, he doesn't even like, Isaiah delivers the message and Hezekiah's not even like, oh my gosh, whatever. Like immediately, verse two, he turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord and said, please, O Lord, remember how I've walked before you in faithfulness and with a whole heart and have done what is good in your sight. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. It's a death sentence. It is the worst. But notice how he prayed and what he prayed to God. It wasn't even so much about his circumstance. It's about him and God. Then the word of the Lord came to Isaiah, verse 4, verse 5. Go and say to Hezekiah, thus says the Lord, the God of David, your father, I've heard your prayer. I've seen your tears. Behold, I'll add 15 years to your life. So when your back's against the wall, all you can do is face your troubles. And we've described this already, different language, but you face your troubles and you fill your mind with your troubles. In a way, you fixate on your troubles. And as you fixate on your troubles, that's all you can see. And that's the only place you can go. So you worry about your troubles. You meditate on your troubles. And when that happens, when you're fixating, when you're focused, when you're meditating on your troubles, they get bigger. And God gets smaller. Just take a moment and think about that. I know that's been true for me. There's places where God's rescued me from bigger stuff, like objectively bigger stuff, larger whole, redeemed me, set me free. And objectively, what I'm working on today, by comparison, it's not the same. But when I get overwhelmed by today and I focus on that, I lose sight of the fact that God is big enough to rescue, because I've made this thing so big that it's dominating me and I don't see how it can be beaten. That's what happens to all of us. But when you turn your back on the troubles and you turn your face to the wall, all you can see is God. And in that moment, that's why the process is so important. That's why we've gone over it every week for 7 weeks. You remember the days of old and you meditate on all that he has done and you ponder the work of his hands and you stretch out your hands to him. And when you're in that place and you turn your face to the wall, you can see God. You see his face. And when you look at his face and his mercy and his compassion and his grace, and you recognize his power and his might and his holiness and his majesty, when you stare at the one who's undefeated, he's always victorious, and then you surrender. You can't help but surrender because you see him as he really is. And God wants you to surrender, but notice who you surrender to. You don't surrender to the wall and its pressures. I think that's so interesting about Hezekiah, because even in his prayer, he doesn't bring that sickness back up when he turns his face to the wall to talk to God and say, this is overwhelming me and this is the worst. What Hezekiah surrenders to is he surrenders to God. Essentially, he says, look, I put myself in your hands. If you'll allow me to add to that feeling and that expression, he goes, listen, Isaiah's told me the thing, but I trust you. And so I turn to you and I ask you to remember me and how I've served you. And you've heard what I read, but I surrender to you and what you're working. See, don't give in. Don't give in to what's got your back against the wall. I don't want you to hear that. Oh, Jonathan just said, all right, whatever that's facing me. No, don't give in. Don't give up. Surrender to God. Give up to him. Surrender to what he's doing in your life through this. Last week, we talked about how to learn from a back against the wall situation. And I gave you 4 ways to learn from your back against the wall trials. And it's good to learn from these times, as we saw. But as we finish these 7 prayers, we see that God is actually after something so much deeper, so much more valuable. See, he doesn't just want to teach you how to learn from him. Hear me. He wants to teach you how to walk with him. Notice once again this final prayer. Let your good spirit lead me. And I told you these 3 words would be so important on level ground. He doesn't say, let your good spirit lead me over this mountain. He doesn't say, let your good spirit rescue me out of this valley. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. You know what that is? That's the everyday. It's not the mountaintops, which are fantastic. It's not the valleys where we feel such acute need. It's the constant, everyday, sometimes boring, operation of your life. In the final prayer, this prayer number 7, David ultimately, so importantly, surrenders. And I can tell you, that's the destination that God has in mind for all of us. That's what God was after in David. And that's what God is after in you throughout your whole life. God wants to walk with you and you with him. We know from the Garden of Eden, that beautiful expression that God walked with Adam and Eve in the garden in the cool of the day. Can I tell you, you were created to walk with God. You were created to know him. It's so valuable. And I'll tell you, throughout my life, it has been so tremendously valuable to know about God, knowing about God's principles and God's precepts and what he considers moral and how to do ethics and how to live my life and where to step and where not step has been so valuable. It's good to know about God. It is even better to know God, to experience him, to know how to reach out and be restored by him. He closes, and I'll close our series with the last two verses of the psalm, the preservation. For your name's sake, O Lord, preserve my life. Again, this is full of faith. This is not a question. This is a certainty. Preserve me in your righteousness. Bring my soul out of trouble. And in your steadfast love, you will cut off my enemies and you will destroy all the adversaries of my soul. For I am your servant. Let me pray for us right now, wherever you are. You can bow with me if you'd like. You can just let me pray over you. It doesn't matter. Lord, I pray as we finish off 12 verses, one psalm, I pray that every single one of us would be people who walk with you, who are led with you, by you, on level ground. You know, it would probably be good for all of us. Just right now. You don't have to do it out loud. You could do it out loud, wherever you are. Just tell God, I surrender your way. I want to know you. I want to know about you, yes, but I want to know you. I want to walk with you. I want you to lead me. If your back's against the wall, just tell him now, Lord, I give in, not to the situation, not to the, I give in to you. Have your way. Take me where you want me. My trust is in you. You're my rescuer. You're my redeemer. I turn into you. In Jesus' name, amen. There's one more prayer I'd like to pray over you, maybe with you. Maybe you're at that place and the surrender you need to make to God today is surrendering to him as your Lord and Savior. I heard a story from a guy one time, and that is actually his sinner's prayer. He knew that God had a plan for his life, and he knew that God was good, and he knew that Jesus was his Savior ultimately. He knew that Jesus came to save us, but he was living life on his own, and he was trying his best, and sometimes not trying his best, sometimes not trying at all, but he knew that he needed to give in, that he needed to trust God as his Lord and Savior. He's always used to tell us, he'd go, it was actually our youth pastor way back in the day, say, I was driving along and it was just I yelled out, I give in, you win. Maybe you've been holding out against God. You know you're not right with God, but I don't know, something's in the way. It's like, you wanna do it your own way, you're not sure you're ready to trust, now is the time to surrender. Maybe you're like, man, I want Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I know I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. Now's the time to surrender. Say, your way, not my way. You're my Lord. You're my Savior. If that's you, I'd love to pray with you. So if we'll just pause right now, you and me. Just pray this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I surrender. You win. I give in. I repent of my sins. I pray that you would cleanse me. Make me right with God. I'm ready for you to take over. I'm ready for you to be my redeemer, for you to be my rescuer, for you to be my savior. I'm ready for you to take over and be Lord. Be in charge of my life. From this moment forward, I'm gonna follow you forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Look, team, if you prayed that prayer, I'm telling you, it's the best decision you've ever made in your life. And we want to help you as you walk that out. That's why I'd like to ask you, our team put up a number on the screen. I'd like to ask you to text the name Jesus. That's our rescuer and redeemer. Text the name Jesus to the number that's on your screen. Our team is going to text back. We're not going to hound you. We're not going to pressure you. We're not going to sign you up for anything. But we'd love to see if we can help you as you journey with Jesus. So text the name Jesus, the number that's on your screen. We'll text back. Then we'll walk with you. For everybody, I'm so glad that you've been a part of this series thus far. My prayer is that God takes this deep in your heart and that He blesses you. Have a great, great day.
Amen. What a powerful message. I love this series. I hope you've been blessed by it as much as we have. Listen, at the end of the message there, Pastor Jonathan gave you an opportunity to start a real relationship with Jesus. And if you just prayed that prayer for the first time, we'd love to connect with you. Would you do us a favor? Would you text the word Jesus to the number on your screen? We'd love to reach out, pray with you, see how we can resource you as you take some practical steps as a new believer. We'd love to help you as you journey with Jesus. Also, maybe you're watching right now and you have a prayer request. We'd love to support you in that. So we have a team standing by that would love to pray with you and stand in the gap and intercede on your behalf. If that's you, just text the word prayer to the number on your screen. We'd love to stand with you in that. Otherwise, God bless. We love you all. Thank you so much for tuning in today, and we'll see you next time.
And now I know that this is the good.